in a world where environment has become essential for the survival of all beings. It is not concerned with only human beings, but other beings also. We are under a wrong concept that this earth is only of the human beings, but this earth is for all beings. Not only living beings like human beings, animals, birds, etc., but for rivers and mountains, forests. So we have to see the world in a totality and think about all beings. And if all beings are to exist together, then it is essential that there is suitable atmosphere for them, not only for their living or getting something to eat, but around them there should be friendly atmosphere. And environment is an atmosphere in which all life survives. And when it is so important for all life, then we should be educated about environment. This is not a simple education of language or arithmetic or history or geography. This is an education which is connected with our survival. And so even those who do not get formal education in schools, it is essential for them. I will tell you a very interesting fact, that the famous Chipko movement was launched by the women who never went to any school, but they were made conscious that this is essential for our very survival, and everybody, all beings want to survive. Nobody wants to die. And the woman who first hugged the tree, she was a lady when she heard that the ash trees from which they got scarcity season fodder for their cattle were being axed by an sports good company to make cricket bats. Oh, she was worried. What will happen to our cattle? From where we will get scarcity season fodder? And this inspired her that I should save the trees even at the cost of my life. Because for hill people and for all, cattle are their best wealth. In our language, Garhwali, we call cattle as dhan, our wealth. So in order to save our wealth, even if we have to give the life, we are prepared for that. And the story goes long with the Mata Devi, with Vishnu, when they said that even at the cost of our head, we have to save the trees. What sort of education about the environment be given to the people? As I told you that there, the question was only for fodder. They wanted fodder for their cattle. But we thought further about it. Fodder comes later. First comes oxygen. Everybody needs oxygen for survival. And then we live in a world where there is so much smoke, and we need something to absorb that smoke. Wherever our civilization goes, with motorcycles and other things, or factories, there is smoke all around, and smoke is very harmful to our health. Other thing essential for life is water. And some people call water is life, but we live in a situation where water sources are depleting and there is a scarcity of water, and there are two threats to the water. One is depletion of water sources and other is pollution of water sources. As I told you that life means water, and if your very life is polluted, then life itself is in danger. Then soil, from which we get our food. And this Chipko movement said, oh, what do the forest bear? Soil, water and pure air. That means our very survival depends upon forests, upon trees. That the real education is of the masses, and it is something different than formal education. And we should call it the education of life, education for life. As we need food to survive, water to survive, similarly we need a clean environment to survive. It comes first, then food and water. You can then live for some time without food, you can live for few hours without water, but not more than 5 minutes without air. Now, there are different aspects of this environmental education. The first thing is our health. How can we remain healthy? Today, we think that only pills can cure us of all our diseases. But pills come later. The real thing is that we should know a way of life in which there is no possibility of falling ill. Pills can cure you only when you are ill. But the best thing is that we should know the ways and means of living in which there is no possibility of falling ill. Yes, there may be some accidents, but not every day living on pills. So first thing is our health. Health is our wealth. And it is said, if health is gone, everything is gone. Only a healthy person can do something. So first is health. Then today the greatest threat to environment is our population. Our population is expanding like this, and the sources of living are squeezing. Less land, less forest, less water, no oxygen. So this increasing population is a great threat to our environment, because whatever the basic capitals you have of soil, water and oxygen, that is limited, and it has to be distributed among all the people. So if population increases, your share will become smaller. And it is not only about the share. Fortunately, nobody can keep air in a box, and nobody can keep air. But water and land, the most powerful people, they will take hold of water and land, and pure people will start. So the first thing we have to do is to control our population, and there should be consciousness about this population, because this earth was made for few, and we are expanding day by day and depleting our resources. In a way, we are eating the share of the coming generations. So we should have a responsibility towards the earth that its resources are not depleted, and the coming generations should also get their proper share from this earth. Today we are under a long concept that civilization is in the cities, urban areas, because we have concentrated the amenities of life in the urban areas. And so people think, oh, the life in the cities is good, and we should go there. We see how our cities are crowding today. People from the villages coming, and even if they have no place to live in, they will start living in the slums. But they think, oh, we are getting some employment here, so there is a, we don't worry if we, even if we have to live in the slum. The people who were, even if they were poor, but they were getting pure air, living water, and an open atmosphere around them in the villages. But when they come in these slums, they cannot go anywhere, and all there are, all around them is a health hazards and many other things. So this is to be made known to the people, and this should be the basic point in our educational program. As I told you, not only formal education, but general education of the people. And today, fortunately, we have radio, television, and then again, the most effective way of educating people is to have personal contact. So this personal touch is more effective, meeting people and moving their hearts, because one thing which has an appeal to our hearts, that remains forever. Today, we are very fortunate that we have the information technology to reach to the masses, and it can be through newspapers, it can be through radio and TV, and so many other methods. And even if a good thing happens in a corner of a country, its news reaches to the people. Then means of transport have become so easy today and so quick today that good messages can be reached to the people. Environment should not be seen in isolation. There is interrelationship between all systems, the rivers, mountains, forests. This whole makes an ecosystem. If you keep the rivers aside and only think about land, it will make no meaning, because rivers are very important with these, for supplying us with water. And as I told you, water is life. That means it is with the use of water that we can live. So these all things make an ecosystem, and which today we have disturbed this ecosystem, because in a mad race to get more and more material things, we have felled the trees and we thought, oh, we can produce more from the land by creating fields. But today there is too much stress on land, and I told you, land has become addicts, demanding more and more chemical fertilizers and water and other things, and a stage may come when there may be dust balls. So this should always be kept in mind, that there is an interrelationship between land, forest, and rivers. They cannot be seen in isolation. If there are forests, then there are rivers also. Perennial rivers, water always flowing in our rivers, because rain comes only once or twice a year. And if all the water flows down to the sea, then what will we do during the rest of the year? So it is forests here come to our rescue, because forests conserve the rain water, and not only conserve it, but purify the water. These forests are very important for our regular water supply and for building up of soil. So this all makes an ecosystem. There is one other mistake which many people make. They say, oh, we should have single crops. These things are precious, So we should only grow the precious things. But in nature, there is no monoculture. Monoculture is just like, imagine, if we have a society of only rulers or only army men. So how can they survive? Because they need food to eat and they need clothes to wear. So in this way, in nature itself also, there are different species, each species supporting the other. Take the example of a tree. A tree cannot live in isolation. There are bushes and grasses to support it. And then there are creepers which the tree supports. So this biodiversity should be maintained. Even in agriculture, now people have reached this conclusion that if you grow only the corns, then the fertility of the land is lost. And I see in our hill societies, there is mixed cultivation. Cultivation of cereals, and along with these cultivations are pulses, because pulses have legumes in their roots and they attract nitrogen and make the soil productive. So this, and nobody gave this education to the people, but it was from their own experience that they learned that the combined cultivation of legumes and corns is good for the health of the soil. And main thing is the health of the soil. So this biodiversity is essential for the health of soil and for flow of our rivers and for keeping the earth covered forever. When you have monocrops and after harvesting, the earth becomes naked. That it is open to the hazards, erosion by wind, erosion by water, and so many other things. So the earth should be kept covered for the whole time, so that its moisture is maintained and the soil particles are together. And lastly, it is the coming generation who should care more for the environment. You will ask, why coming generation? Because this earth we have inherited from our ancestors, and this is the property of coming generations. We are only the caretakers of this earth, not the masters of this earth. So the students, the new generation, they should be more careful about it, and they should know that this is their property, this is their wealth. It is not the property of their parents alone. Parents are the caretakers of this earth, but the real masters, they are of this earth. So they should take care of this earth, and they should take care about the environmental problem. They should say, oh, we do not want this pollution, we do not want smoke, we do not want this draft. All the hazards, they should be conscious about these. And it is only being conscious is not enough, but acting, doing something to protect the Mother Earth. Because if you say, oh, we will protect Mother Earth, but if you do not give up consumerism, if you go on increasing your demands on earth, then the earth will not be able to bear the burden of this exploitation. So what we have to do today, we have to practice austerity in our lives. And in our society, especially in Indian culture, one who lives on less and less things is respected most in the society. One who will take more things, he will not respect us so much. He becomes a butcher of earth. So first thing is austerity, And second, we have to find out alternatives of those activities which are hurting Mother Earth and other resources. And thirdly, we all should keep in mind that future of our Earth depends upon trees. The third is afforestation. Trees will give us oxygen, trees will act as sinks of carbon dioxide, trees will conserve water and purify the water, keep the flow of our rivers constant, and trees will serve as factories of soil manufacture. So in this way, the trees can be our guards, the guardians of Mother Earth. And if the young people realize this thing, they should plant more trees and protect whatever trees there are on this earth. And if they will complain later on, oh, everything is gone, then what can they do? Because a tree takes too much time to grow. And a living tree is a wealth to the society. So all living trees should be protected and new trees should be planted according to the needs of the people, according to the needs of oxygen, water, food, and soil manufacturers.